Yeah, welcome. Welcome very, very much to Conversation. We've got a program here. We're producing it with Skype with our good friend Jim Fetcher, who will be known to many of the people in the audience now. He's up. He's moving around, apparently. I thought he was up in Duluth. I had you pegged as being in the same town that Bobby Dylan came out of and so forth. But apparently you're on the move. A moving target is hard to hit. And I'll bet you've got a number of people who would like to hit you with a great big bow and arrow or something, given the sense of your... He's Distinguished McKnight University Professor. I'm not sure where he's associated now. But, Jim, welcome so much to Conversation. It's so good to be in touch with you.
Oh, Harold, it's such a delight to be with you once again since years back when we had the great pleasure. Yes, Bob Dylan came from Duluth. Now it's best known for the Duluth Trading Company, which has these unbelievable commercials on television.
I don't know that at all. I don't know that thing. But there's a couple of things on television that doesn't seem worth viewing to me. And you've had a very good hand in pointing out a lot of the things that probably could have been cleaned up, that have been imprinted over our media to the population, that ought to be re-examined and tightened up in terms of veracity in many, many quarters.
Well, you're right. You're right, Harold. After a 35-year career offering courses principally in logic, critical thinking, and scientific reasoning, I retired in 2006. Uh-huh. And since then, I have become very much involved in research on conspiracies. I even had a show on Gary Null's PRNFM entitled The Conspiracy Guy. Uh-huh. Until I got too deep into Parkland exposing what was going on. Gary thought that was disheartening, not that it wasn't true, and the program was abbreviated, taken off the air. Not the only time I've been given the boot, but the fact is that the American people have become the audience for the world's greatest political theater, which is being conducted by the political parties, in this case primarily the Democratic Party, taking advantage of the mainstream media. And the fact that it's been for so long controlled by the CIA, it began infesting the media in the 1950s, so that by 1975, Harold, William Colby, then its director, could testify to Congress that the agency owned everyone of any significance in the media. Uh-huh. Carl Bernstein followed that up with an article in Rolling Stone entitled The CIA and the Media in 22 October 1977, when he explained that the officials of the agency had boasted that their greatest successes had been with Time Life, the New York Times, and CBS. Harold, in that era, if you controlled Time Life, the New York Times, and CBS, you pretty much had a lock on American...
What year are you referencing in that, Jim? What year are you referencing?
Carl Bernstein was 77.
77,
and was
okay,
25.
So
that the media has been, by and large, dominated by the CIA and by their allies. Actually, people who are connected with Israel, the Zionists, have had an unbelievable influence on our media. If you were to study, you'd find there are 100 dual citizen Zionists working for the New York Times. You got another 100 working for CNN. You got another 100 working for NBC. I mean, it's absolutely stunning, Harold, the extent to which our media is under the control, basically, of a foreign entity.
Which foreign entity are you talking? Some people are saying it's coming out of Moscow. Other people say it's coming out of Tel Aviv. You know, I don't know.
Tel Aviv, without any doubt,
Where's
Harold,
the home
these people
base
are
of the
dual. These are people dual U.S.-Israeli citizens. They're very strong Zionists.
Oh, yeah, I know that. Yeah, right. Yeah, I know. I've done programs with Yasser Arafat. I hate what's going
on. The
whole
Moscow thing was a fabrication. It was a... effort to discredit Trump. They fabricated, you know, the justification using a fake dossier that the DNC and Hillary had paid for in order to get the FISA court to authorize surveillance on the Trump campaign. There's a brilliant expose, by the way, by Greg Jarrett entitled The Russia Hoax.
I think I know that name. Yeah, I'm not. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah,
for many years. I mean, look, two investigative journalists who are following Hillary's campaign reported in their book Shattered, published just after the election, that John Podesta and Robbie Mook had made up the Russian hacking meme in order to cover up the inadequacies in their campaign, the fact that the WikiLeaks revelations led to Pizzagate, where John Podesta himself appears to be the pedophile in chief, and Hillary's own involvement with Russia, where she sold off 20% of U.S. uranium to Russia through a Canadian company called Uranium One for $145 million donation to the Clinton Foundation. Harold.
Yeah, she did. She was good at fair time. Now, let me ask you something, Jim, if I can. You're running off a lot of things and everything like that. Are there any sources of good guys in the world, or is the whole world establishment, political and or intellectual, bad guys by your lights, in that nobody is able to cotton to or cuddle up to what is the real fate of humanity on this planet in this year of 2018?
Well, that's a very interesting question, Harold, and some of your audience may be dumbfounded at the answer, but Vladimir Putin is the only true statesman astride the world stage, and close behind him, if only he'd followed through on his commitments to improve relations with Russia, is, believe it or not, Donald Trump, who, apart from his mismanagement of foreign policy in the Middle East, which is clearly too much under Zionist control, is doing everything he can to clean up the deep state. And I believe that after this midterm, a lot is going to happen in very short order. And I say these things, even critical of Hillary and Barack Obama, who, by the way, had to approve that sale of 20% of U.S. uranium, even though I was in the past a Democrat. I voted twice for Bill Clinton. I voted twice for Barack Obama. But when it came to Hillary, her sordid history of corruption was too much. I saw that Donald as having the potential to be a new broom sweeping clean. And when he promised to get us out of the Middle East and to move to restore America, I thought that was the right answer to the right problem. Studies by the University of Minnesota and Boston University, by the way, have shown that was the key to his success in his contest with Hillary, where rural counties in Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, and Wisconsin, which had suffered many casualties from the wars in the Middle East, judged him to be the less likely to continue the wars in the Middle East, and that was why he won the election. Interestingly, Michael Moore even predicted this would happen because Hillary was neglecting those very states. Yeah. And indeed, she never even came to Wisconsin, where I moved after that 35-year career concluded in Duluth, where I now reside in a village by the name of Oregon, just south of Madison, Wisconsin.
Are you retired now? Is that it from academia or not? Or are you still teaching or what?
I'm retired now, but my wife, I'm busier now than I was when I was teaching full-time, actually.
I was going to ask you, are you, now that you're retired, you can really get to work and not have to fill out faculty forms and whatnot? And
doing the most important research of my life.
Free at last. Thank God Almighty, we're free at last out of academia. Huh?
That's right. That's right. That's right. And Harold, what the public has to understand is that Barack Obama performed many disservices to the American people. In particular, a key event was the Smith-Mundt Modernization Act of 2012. This nullified a statute from 1948 that precluded the use of the same techniques of propaganda and disinformation within the United States that the American intelligence agencies were using abroad. Yeah. It was brought to us just in time for Sandy Hook, which was the first in a whole string of these theatrical performances. I have done a huge amount on each of these. I bring together the best experts on different aspects of these cases. and have published books about Sandy Hook, the Boston bombing, Orlando and Dallas, Charlottesville. Yeah. We've just published a book about Parkland. We are publishing a book about Las Vegas. Harold, these are all in addition to all the collaborative research I've done, where I published multiple books on JFK, four altogether, and two on 9/11, which was brought to us compliments of the CIA, the neocons, and the Department of Defense, and the Mossad.
Let me ask you something a little bit off, a little bit off kilter, or something like that. You're actually coming up with a thing. You're being recorded in this program for what's called public access in New York City and the world. And I would venture to say that most all of the programming that goes on public access is what would be called left wing, almost without exception. And you're celebrating, in a certain sense, the personage of Mr. Trump, which a good deal of the left wing, who has been part of what's been called the progressive movement, is very, very suspect. In fact, they're waiting for Mr. Mueller to come forth and Mr. What's-His-Name out of California is saying it's time for impeachment of our president. What I want to ask you, is there any time in the past you have such a favorable relationship to a major leader of the world society, politically, economically, intellectually, and so forth, as to give a thumbs up to of Mr. Trump? Has there ever been anybody in the leadership element of the world society, intellectual, political, or otherwise, that you've been able to give a thumbs up to out of your past history that hasn't been has to be taken off the pillar of acceptance and celebrating due to the things that came after you gave that kind of an accolade to anybody in the past at all? And that includes Jesus.
My lifetime accolade, Harold. My pantheon of heroes includes John F. Kennedy, Robert Kennedy. I have gladly given my life for either.
Wow.
Muhammad Ali and Bill Russell, by the way. More recently, Muammar Gaddafi, with whom you had a personal relationship,
is
someone I admire. Vladimir Putin is a great statesman astride the world stage. These are figures who count in a significant way in my inventory of those who have made a difference to the world.
You've done very, very well in pointing out that there are a lot of people who are being celebrated by intellectuals and opinion speakers and media people and so forth for their acumen and their ability to have an understanding of foreign policy and things that are up for grabs, as it were, and so forth. Who do you think there is now outside of Mr. Trump? He's showing the deep state. Maybe you could explain that to some of the people who are upset with him and are thinking that they may be heading for an impeachment of the man in the name of his facing or his representing a fascist movement similar to Mr. Mussolini and his cousin, Mr. Adolf.
Well, this is a profound misunderstanding of Donald Trump. He's not a racist. He's never had bad relationships. He was a great success in New York City. You know, he was in real estate, a developer, an architect. Yeah. Already on 9/11, Harold, he was being interviewed on, I recall, as it was Channel 9, explaining that he had the same builders working for him now that had put up the Twin Towers, that planes could not have done it. It was actually physically impossible for those buildings to have collapsed. The very modest fires that remain were trivial and insignificant. It was done with a sophisticated arrangement of mini or micro nukes. It's a very complex story. But Trump was explaining that something else had to be involved. He mentioned specifically bombs, and this was on the streets of New York on the day of 9/11.
Well, there are some people who could have done that. Does he hold with that now? And who was it that was responsible, in his view, or yours, for bringing down the Twin Towers?
Well, the whole thing originated in the fertile imagination of Bibi Netanyahu back in the 1980s.
So you're targeting Israel.
Well, that and who benefits?
Are you targeting Zionism?
Harold, you have to ask who benefits. 9/11 was orchestrated in order to draw the United States into endless wars in the Middle East to take out the modern Arab states that serve as a counterbalance to Israel's domination of the region and eventually to confront the Persian nation of Iran. It would have been a complete success, but for the intervention of Russia and Iran on behalf of Syria at the request of the Syrian government. The United States has derived no benefit. It squandered vast resources, trillions of dollars, thousands of lives, not to mention the millions of Arabs who have died in this contest, all to benefit Israel. I'm sorry to say, Harold, the case for this is simply overwhelming. I most recently collaborated with Robert David Steele, who's a former CIA official who's gone public with his information. He believes all intelligence should be shared, everything should be open. We constructed a memorandum series, 28 memoranda from 27 experts on 9/11 for the President of the United States. You can download it from his website, Robert David Steele, or he has a tiny URL, something like 9/11-POTUS, P-O-T-U-S. You won't have any trouble downloading it for free, and you'll find the evidence laid out there in spades. Alternatively, of course, you could go to moonrockbooks.com and you could order America Nuked on 9/11, compliments of the CIA, the neocons, and the Department of Defense, where I brought together 15 experts there.
What about the government of Mr. Netanyahu and that coterie of people who were behind it?
Absolutely.
Try to make that claim in New York City or in the United States of America, and you will be non grata in many, many prisons and so forth.
Sure. But that's because popular opinion and the truth need not coincide. You can have widely held views that are nevertheless demonstrably false, and this is a perfect example.
Yeah.
There were members of the Port Authority who transferred the World Trade Center into the hands of Larry Silverstein. He took control just 6 weeks before. These were all avid Zionists. They're out to benefit Israel. The towers were white elephants. They were loaded with asbestos. They were actually under a directive from the Port Authority to remove the asbestos. It couldn't be done by a classic controlled demolition because all that asbestos and other toxic particles would have been exposed.
So it was a good business arrangement to bring them down.
Oh, of course.
It was a smart business move.
Yes, it was.
Trump's very good at smart business moves, is he not?
Silverstein fired the security firm that had been looking after the World Trade Center since it first opened in 1970, hired an Israeli firm, Kroll, renegotiated the insurance coverage for the World Trade Center to include a terrorist clause, so that when there were purportedly two planes, he claimed double indemnity, collected about $4.5 billion on $114 million investment, Harold. Constructing scaffolding around 110-story buildings would have been prohibitively expensive, estimated as much as $1 billion apiece. But to have a terrorist attack that conveniently brings about the demolition of these buildings beyond his control, virtually as though it were an act of God, was incredibly convenient.
Yeah.
And it should justify, by the fabricated claim that it was perpetrated by 19 Islamic terrorists under the control of a guy off in a cave in Afghanistan, Harold. Yeah. I mean, that was a perfect scenario to move forward with an invasion of Afghanistan.
Was that whole thing a gigantic lie?
Yes.
Uh-huh. And it should be known. And is that able to be said in the press or in the popular press or anything of that anywhere in the Western world?
Well, I'm giving you sources.
Except Jim Fetzer's.
Find it documented in spades. I also did a two-hour overview. Harold, I did a two-hour overview about 9/11 where I present all the evidence with Brian Ruhe, R-U-H-E. You can find it on BitChute, B-I-T-C-H-U-T-E. So many of my videos have been taken down from YouTube. They've been running a massive onslaught against me and other students of conspiracy and seeking to suppress conservative.
Now, where is the nest of the conspiracy? Where does it go? Does it go back into the mists of history? Was there ever a good leadership element in a political system? And also, you're talking about Israel, and then you're talking about the Muslim world, and there seems to be this idea of the 12th Imam, and there also seems to be a group of people in the Judaic tradition called Natura Carta, who are very much against the establishment of the State of Israel, which is a burning point of a conflict that has been established in the world, but that in the Jewish tradition of that, the end time, are we in end times now? There are reasons to think that the whole human evolutionary process, after 200,000 years of our existence, is coming to an end time of qualitative transformation, like punctuated equilibrium and evolution. And we're coming to that, but that in the Judaic tradition, that is not to happen. That is not to happen in terms of Israel or anything of that sort until the Mashiach. The Mashiach has not appeared, as far as we know, in the Judaic tradition, and also in the, particularly in the Iranian branch of Islam, they also have the idea of the 12th Imam. That's a period of the appearance of a global leader of spiritual importance and political reality that is able to usher in with the leadership of that person a new order of things transcending our 200,000 year sojourn on this planet. Do you think we're going through anything like that when we've got weapons that are, now, I'll just summarize this in a minute. Do you think the weapons systems that have evolved as a means of asserting political power throughout all of history have finally reached a point, particularly those in the hands of the United States of America, that if they're to be unleashed would mean the end of a Homo sapiens species? Is that only baloney, or is that an actual geopolitical reality that exists that has never existed until just yesterday?
Well, let me offer several reflections on this very vast question you have raised.
Yeah.
Most of philosophers, and I in particular am a philosopher of science,
yes,
I am not a religious person.
Yeah,
I am an agnostic, recognizing that neither the existence of God nor the non-existence of God are amenable to rational proof. This is why they are articles of faith.
Yeah.
You won't find any priests or rabbis or ministers who dispute that, Harold.
Yeah.
These are things you believe, even in the absence of evidence, or what might even be construed as evidence to the contrary. Misadventures of man, including wars and calamities.
Yeah, 200,000 year sojourn.
As a student of evolution, on which I have published
numerous
articles,
please,
one entitled "The Evolution of Intelligence: Are Humans the Only Animals with Minds?" and the other, "Render Unto Darwin," about the religious rights attack on science here.
I
must say that our cognitive capabilities and our forms of governmental organization and our politics have brought us to a situation where we may very well be on the verge of a nuclear Armageddon of our own making.
And is that is that Armageddon in its capability? We couldn't have done it in the Second World War. We couldn't have done it a couple of decades ago. But now we've come to a point where that is, in fact, the existential reality. We now can wipe out the entire Homo sapiens species with our extended technological capability of making war.
That's right. It all revolves around the existence of nuclear weapons, Harold, that is the key, which Ronald Reagan, for example, understood were the greatest threat to mankind when he worked out the resolution with Mikhail Gorbachev over the dissolution of the Soviet Union. We make solemn promises that we would not encroach on the newly independent nations that had formerly been a part of the Soviet bloc.
We're doing a lot of intervention, don't you think? The United States of America?
Which we respected, by the way, until the era of Bill Clinton, who began violating those solemn agreements. Well, I mean, these are the most serious treaties into which we have ever entered. Yeah, and now, of course, the Russians are quite alarmed by the emplacement of all of these missile systems on their border, ostensibly to counter an Iranian missile threat. But it's all ridiculous. Yeah. The Iranians, our own intelligence agencies concluded already by 2007, we're not pursuing nuclear weapons. If they had, it was only because of the threat posed by Iraq, where they'd been involved in an eight-year war from 1980 to 1988 that had cost about a million souls on both sides, Harold.
Don't you think the war in Iraq was a big mistake?
Oh, huge. Everything. Huge, all of our involvement in the Middle East has been a colossal tragedy. Mm-hmm. But the fact is that Trump is now being advised by neocons who are really Zionists. These include John Bolton and Mike Pompeo.
Yeah.
And Bolton is promoting the abandonment of the INF treaty with the Russians, which precluded the development of intermediate range ballistic missiles from 500 to 3,500 miles range, so that the Russians wouldn't feel threatened pulling out, because these systems we have there can be so easily adapted. Russia regards those as first strike weapons. Trump continues to pull out. The consequences could be horrific for humanity, could lead to the extinction of all life on Earth.
And that's some of that.
My judgment, the most important film ever made was Stanley Kubrick's Dr. Strangelove.
Wasn't that
citizen of the world should watch that film at least once every year.
I've watched it about 400 times, I think, something like that. It was just absolutely incredible film. And the media can be very important in doing all of that. But one gets around to, if I heard you right, and you're talking about many, many large themes, and I respect tremendously your ability and so forth, but I heard you say there, I thought, that Mr. Trump might have some problems of his own, and yet you still say that he's the one who we might repair to get a sense of reality that is realistic. But he is also in the case, a case can be made that he is a danger at that level of unleashing the weapons of mass destruction with his egocentric notion of things.
It's a distinction between domestic politics and foreign affairs.
Okay, draw the distinction. It's important, please.
By and large, what he's doing domestically and taking on the mainstream media, which was long since co-opted by the CIA and the Zionists, he's exposing the fake news media. In fact, they're going bananas because of the development of the alternative media through the internet. They were never seriously challenged until now, which is why the social media giants, Google, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, are cracking down so seriously on conservative voices and on conspiracy research, because it puts the lie to the mainstream stories. Like Sandy Hook, like the Boston bombing, like Parkland, like Charlottesville. These are all staged and orchestrated events, Harold, where I have exposed them in collaboration with the best students to study these cases and publish them in the books you see in the background here.
Yeah, I know. You sounded like you were in the Library of Congress there. That picture of you is quite an injury. You're surrounded by these massive number of works that you've done. I know you've been working majorly. One of the things on that same vector of the destruction capability, usually there's a sort of yin and yang to things in terms of philosophy and the understanding and that sort of thing. And the yin and the yang and this assumption, it can be modeled and presented as a almost without question factual thing about the destructive capability. Do you think in an equally significant moment evolutionarily that we now have a capability of being able to have a world order where the insanely incompetent systems of essentially human slavery that has been done in order to build up the human artifices and so forth, that there's never been just. There's never been a real just order. It's always been a few people at the top in charge of everything, and they've not been able to be in an era where there can be the hope of there being, as an adverse side to the destructive scenario of the atomic weaponry, there's a capability through the technology of finally getting past zero sum. For one to lose, others have to lose. The assumption of scarcity, are we at a point where we may be able to be modeling on the assumption that there is, for the first time, enough for all to be able to live the life of a civilized and maximally engaged population, rather than a fundamentally unjust one, which has always just favored a few people at the top and continues in terms of the broad structure of human society now?
Well, if you're looking for distributive justice, you're going to find very little of it in the world today.
Right.
One of the major problems, of course, is overpopulation. But it ought to be done in a humane, voluntary way. That's why I regard family planning, birth control, to be among the most important elements of human life today. I would have been very upset if I believed that Brett Kavanaugh were going to undermine Roe v. Wade, but he has a great respect for precedent. It would create social chaos. I'm very strongly committed to a woman's right to choose. What could be more democratic and American than allowing every woman in her own unique set of circumstances to decide whether or not to bear a fetus to term?
Well, that's one issue. That is an issue. I'm trying to hoik it up on its own petard or something, this larger collective capability of providing life support with systems that can provide a material reality where everybody in the world can become, on their own terms, what is called a have. It's never been. The only people that could be a have in the castle on the hill were the few, and that still holds in terms of the holdover from history. Are we transcending perhaps material scarcity as an ontologic reality for which we can begin to plan and set up the systems that are going to keep us together and perhaps begin to usher in a period of liberation rather than annihilation of the Homo sapien species in our time?
In an ideal world, Harold, but yeah. you had a microcosm in Libya.
Yes, sir. I couldn't agree with you more.
Yeah. He had the essence of benevolent dictator. Aristotle, in his assessment forms of government, observed that a benevolent dictator was the most efficient and beneficial to the people, because as a dictator, he could make things happen, and because he was benevolent, he would be doing them to benefit the people. Gaddafi was using the oil resources of Libya to benefit the Libyan people. He was providing national health care, national public education, national warehouses stocked full of food. If you had a medical problem that could be not dealt with in Libya, he'd fly you and a friend or relative anywhere in the world, all expense paid by the government, to have it treated. But he was also introducing the gold dinar, which would rapidly have become the currency of all of Africa, and developing the Great Waterworks Project, which would have turned North Africa into a veritable oasis.
Well, it was already in place, the Great Man River Project. And in that sense, I'm familiar. I counted him a friend. I liked Stokely Carmichael also. Kwame Ture was a friend. And there were a number of people from the Amerindian movement, Vernon Bellacore and that sort of thing. The broad brush of human society that's been ill-treated, such as the blacks, the American Indians, and so forth, that he had a pattern. And when he came to power, for whatever it's worth, they had a 6% literacy rate. In about 20 years, it became 98%. Boys and girls, all in school, all educated and up. And he also had a way of forming capital in which if you started a private, there's always been a dispute between private property, the private sector and the public sector in terms of government and business and so forth. In his country, he wasn't against doing away with the private sector like a lot of socialists would want to do, or a lot of leftists would want to do, away with the the people who are at the top. There's still only a handful of people who own all the assets and the benefits of the economic order. But he set it up to where you could start a business in Bolivia. He wasn't against doing, he didn't want to do away with the private sector at all. In fact, he encouraged it, and you could start a business there. And the one rule, this is funny, Jay, the one rule he had, I went to factories and things like that, you could set up, you could start a factory, and you could not pay wages. You couldn't pay any wages. The way some distribution of buying power to the people is by giving them a wage for what is like a serf-like relationship to the leadership element of the old order and so forth. But you couldn't do that. You had to make them be the owners of the capital asset underpinnings to that corporate structure. Do you understand? And that's still a challenge that we have not come up with a way to get a sense of economic justice based upon the economic production of our extended technological capability in the corporate sector. Do you think there's any way in which, and for that reason, I think he was why he was attacked more than the thing about the gold thing in Europe. I mean, in Africa.
Well, Hillary.
He was ahead of history, like Thomas Jefferson was ahead of feudalism in 1776.
Well, as the revelation, the publication of Hillary Clinton's emails have revealed by WikiLeaks, Harold, the French were upset with Gaddafi's growing influence, including the Waterworks project, because they wanted to keep Africa as their own neocolonial preserve. And Western banking interests, read that Rothschilds, where Gaddafi once observed, if you want to end terrorism in the world, just lob a cruise missile into the city of London, the one square mile in the city of London where the Rothschild Empire is located.
Yeah.
And they wanted to get a hold in the Muslim countries where usury or making money off of money, in other words, interest, is forbidden. By Islam. So those were principal motives. When I learned that the rebel group in Libya, as its first act, was to found a new central bank, I knew something was profoundly wrong. Hillary was in the driver's seat with the slaughter of the Libyan people. It was brutal. Gaddafi didn't even put up a fight. The people were slaughtered. He volunteered to surrender to a location specified by the Department of State. Hillary had his convoy proceeding under a white flag of surrender interdicted. She had him brutally castrated, sodomized with a bayonet, and murdered. She would later cackle about it. She would paraphrase Julius Caesar in relation to the Gallic Wars.
He had
observed, "I came, I saw, I conquered." She said, "We came, we saw, he died," and laughed about it. It was a disgrace, Errol.
It's sort of like an extension of the treatment by some people of Jesus Christ, and also of Spartacus and other people who have claimed to have something that was really threatening to the political support of the leadership element du jour. That is not up to date with what they need, and not to have anything come along that's going to challenge their basic premise for having their leadership role unquestioned by anybody.
Yes, you're 100% correct.
That's the situation that we're in now. So we're back to the original question I tried to ask you, Pop. Are you thinking there could be a opposing system of understanding of how we're going to organize, form capital, organized distribution of buying power, organized institutions for establishing a just economic order for all, women, children, for all, that is unparalleled by anything in history, and we can't find something out of history. We're looking for something new, as in punctuated equilibrium in terms of evolutionary process. You get to a certain, we've been here 200,000 years, and that's 10,000 generations, and about time for there to be a qualitative, not a quantitative, little change of the chess players out of history, but a qualitative transformation, which could be something like a liberated way for a maximally engaged, massive human participation along with the environmental context, which is required for that to be achieved. We came into that period. It's not just another moment in history. It's a qualitatively new time in history that calls for a new way of understanding.
I'm inclined to respond, as did Mahatma Gandhi, when asked what he thought about Western civilization. He said he thought it was a good idea.
Right. Well, Western or Eastern or wherever. I mean,
history. No, the point is we're an uncivilized West.
Yeah, we're an uncivilized species.
Exploiting.
No, we're an uncivilized species because we had to be.
Harold, you can't envision a future that's inconsistent with human nature if there are propensities.
No, but then human nature's not good enough. We have to have something in advance. And James Joyce had Daedalus say. James Joyce, not a bad poet.
Listen, I agree.
Wait a minute. He had Daedalus say, history is a nightmare, one could add, of injustice. It's always been unjust in the collective from which we're attempting to awaken. We are awakening to a new way, non-scarcity as an ontologic understanding of our capability rather than scarcity, which all our institutions are based upon, and the fighting over scarce resources for who gets to get the major part of the booty. And we need something new, and we don't have it coming. But Gaddafi had a little bit of that that could have been new emerging out of it and so forth. And we trashed it.
Well, let me draw a comparison between Barack Obama and Donald Trump at this point presidencies.
Yeah.
Obama's approval rating was 45. Trump's is about 50. The unemployment rate with Obama was 9.4. With Trump, it's 3.9. Jobs added minus negative 2.9 million under Obama. Jobs added 3.2 million under Trump.
Yeah,
First-year deficit under Obama, 1.4 trillion. Under Trump, 665 billion. GDP growth under Obama, 1.6. Under Trump, 4.1.
Yeah,
These are facts of the matter that the liberal left is not willing to acknowledge.
Well, maybe, but there could have been things like that that comes out of other phases in history of a temporary nature and so forth, too.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is you got to work at these things piecemeal. You have to think in terms of reform rather than revolution. Well, the problem is that the Democrats really have lost their way. They have entered an era of corruption unparalleled, where they're staging all these phony attacks. I mean, look, those allegations of sexual impropriety by Brett Kavanaugh were all manufactured. Blasey Ford even comes from a CIA family. She's involved in the abortion industry. She may have been worried that Roe v. Wade would be undermined, which I affirm is not the case, nor did Susan Collins.
But these
escalating sequence of allegations that became increasingly more and more absurd were ridiculous.
Isolated implications of the confusion of which is going on right now, and you're arguing in the same old way and so forth, and not paying attention to the fact, are we at a time of qualitative transformation, which makes possible something that the historical pattern and comparing the various people who've argued about how many men can fit on the end of a pin and all those kind of arguments we've made by people who are variously invested in the economic order better than somebody else doing it. The same old argument's been going on for 200,000 years, and it doesn't seem to ever be brought up. Is there something new? Is there a way in which it could be forming capital? Is there a way in which we could be having a genuinely liberated order rather than one that is based upon inherently and absolutely necessary for one to win? Somebody else has to lose, and that's been the history of the whole thing. Can't we get at something that is going to bring a system that is going to make it so everybody can win on their own terms in a way that's never been available to us by our extended technological capability? Is that the case, or are we doomed maybe to fight each other to the point where we'll finally unleash the weapons and pack it all in for this planet? That we're at that kind of a time. It's not the Second World War.
If you're asking me to surmise whether it's more probable we're going to realize some kind of utopian, humane future for the world versus a nuclear apocalypse, I'm sorry to say that Dr. Strange had it right. You know, nuclear apocalypse is overwhelmingly more likely than a humane utopia for the future. But
go ahead.
Take the right steps in the right order. It's all piecemeal, Harold.
Yeah, right. I know. Well, that's what I'm trying to get at, a larger context, rather than the piecemeal argument of what we all do in the same way we've been arguing over 200,000 years of human history. We haven't got a vision. We've had some. Muammar Gaddafi actually offered something new. Thomas Jefferson ordered something new to feudalism that had been there for 1,000 years after Rome in Europe. It was something new. So they came and bombed Washington in 1812 because they were pissed that we didn't stand up to their understanding of history. We had something new. It was called democracy in the New World. We need something new now, and our leadership is not providing it, intellectually or otherwise, or even a vision of it. That's all I'm saying.
That's because you want to go from point A to point B, and point A is a very complicated distribution of power, wealth, and resources in society.
Yeah.
And to get to point B, you would require a major transformation arrangement and distribution.
Yeah, right. Absolutely. That's right. Justice, not injustice. It's always been unjust in terms of the collective whole. It's never been just. It's always been a few ruling everything, everybody else, kings, knights, and so forth. But now we're in a time of qualitative transformation that is totally unique, and there should be some intellectually understanding. How do we get past the zero-sum thinking of limited resources? That's the thing. That's the thing that's held it back and forced us back into the same old nostrums that we've had to do throughout history.
Well, I can give you a lot of recommendations for steps that can be taken to regain, so the American people can regain some semblance of control over their own government, which include getting rid of electronic voting machines, which have been used to steal election after election, get rid of gerrymandered districts that have the same representative reelected, so it's virtually impossible to replace them. Get rid of private money in federal elections, which should all be publicly funded.
Yeah.
Most surprisingly, Harold, restore the draft. Nixon eliminated the draft,
the
anti-war movement, but it created a detachment of most American families from decisions of war and peace. Well, as long as we had the draft, American families cared about these decisions because they knew their own family, their daughters and sons might have to pay a price, suffer in a war. But now that they can let others do it because of a volunteer military, they no longer care. And the executive has acquired far too much power in making decisions about engagements, for example, in the Middle East, as a perfect illustration.
That's all to the good and everything like that. So one last little thing. We're coming down to the end. We're coming to the end. I'm just making a sort of joke here. We're coming to the end of time.
The program versus the end of the world.
Yeah, right. That kind of thing and everything. But are you optimistic or pessimistic? I'm of an opinion that we live in unusual times. They're not normal times. History is a nightmare of injustice. There's never been real justice in all of human or evolutionary history. And there's something new needed. And we appeared out of evolution 200,000 years ago. That was a pretty long run we've had as a species. We're coming into a time of qualitative transformation that could be where, instead of it being unjust or unjust, it's able to tap the full capability of a liberated humanity that will give a resonancy that will inter-accommodate us to universe at a level transcendent to what we've been for 200,000 years in relationship to the cosmos. We may be coming into a new, that's the process of speciation. We're going through a moment. It's not just like the First World War, the Second World War, Civil War, or Rome. It's something that is new, is called for. And I wonder if there's any chance that we can come up with that from our intellectual, how we're going to form capital, how are we going to distribute buying power to the mass of the people to get the good living things that can be produced by our technological capability, which is displacing labor in the productive process. You know, how are you going to get buying power into the hands of the world citizenry to clear the market of the great things that might be able to be produced in an ecologically appropriate order, which we now have the capability of doing, which we haven't had. Trying to get the basis for a possible rosy picture of the future, rather than just a reifying of the outdated institution that could lead to disaster.
Harold, I admire your altruism, your vision, your aspirations. I commend you 100%, but they have to be rooted in realism about the current state of affairs in the world.
Well, let's do that.
The greatest threats we pose come from nuclear sources, nuclear energy on the one hand, because we run the risk of catastrophes like Fukushima or Chernobyl, and nuclear wars on the other.
Well, you know, James Hansen still wants us to tap the force of the tridents. It's the tridents in the American fleet that is the major threat, and you could tap an atomic energy in order to get electric development. You wouldn't have to go to all kinds of other things. There's ways in which you could trap nuclear energy and have as an energy source. Just take it right out of the damn Trident submarines and put it into a thing producing the well. You got the source.
Harold, the Trident. We haven't even figured out a way to dispose of our nuclear waste.
I know.
A mountain. Yucca Mountain is porous, it's a volcanic, and it's above an aquifer.
These
steel drums have a very finite lifespan. How can we introduce a form of energy technology where we can't dispose of the waste, which is radioactive for thousands and thousands of years?
I admit that's a minor problem. I'm trying to loosen up a little bit.
It's a minor problem, like getting the mainstream press to report the truth instead of propaganda.
The system of production is becoming increasingly technological. It's all owned by a tiny plutocratic class that fight each other over who gets the spoils. And we got to have something where that can be the productive capability and growth of that has to be extended to everybody. The forming of capital has to be done in a way where the ownership of it is distributed to everybody as a way of distributing effective buying power.
Harold, I'll just say, in terms of the short term...
Mr. Gaddafi was doing that.
And look at the fate he incurred.
Because the people at the switch in Washington don't have a vision that I'm saying they ought to be having, the world leadership ought to be having.
Look, let me make a few reflections here
by
about the current
means,
political
boy,
situation.
You're a major scholar, and I thank you for your
work. Several traps for Trump. One was the Kavanaugh hearing. He was able to evade that. Susan Collins was masterful. Jeff Flakes, having the FBI supplemental investigation, turned out to be pivotal, absolutely fundamental in convincing us there was no substance to any of these allegations. Then we have the caravan headed toward the western border of the United States. You cannot have a nation without enforcing the border. Migrants aren't the problem. Illegal migrants are the problem. Just as Kanye West said in the White House, legal guns aren't the problem. Illegal guns are the problem.
There's truth to what you say, sir. There are a couple of problems. I don't doubt that, or I don't question that. There's a couple of problems left.
A couple
I'm
of problems left indeed.
I'm trying to make
and then you
joke.
Had this pipe bomb thing, which was simply absurd. The bombs weren't even functional. They don't seem to have been sent through the mail. The guy had a rap sheet as long as your arm, but the cases were all dismissed. He had a van that was covered with high quality stickers. I lived in Florida for 5 years.
Very good art.
I lived in Florida for 5 years, Harold.
Yes, sir.
You can't have stickers on a van that don't become sun bleached, and all those were professional quality, and it struck me immediately.
You're right, sir. I tell you, you're right.
You can't cover the windows of a van in Florida and have it legally on the road. That was my first point about it.
Right, right.
Well, all these little stunts are being performed to try to gain votes for the Democrats. It's all corrupt. They have lost their way. It's like Howard Dean denouncing a website because it exercises freedom of speech.
Yeah.
We have to reaffirm the freedom of the press, freedom of speech, and our right to keep and bear arms.
Absolutely.
Chicago demonstrates as clearly as anyone could ask that gun control laws won't work.
That's a lot of shooting going on there. But listen, one thing I have to say is I'm afraid we could go on talking for a long time and everything, but I'm afraid we've run out of time for this. So we have another couple of minutes, but I think we ought to try and maybe loosen it up and bring a little bit of understanding to it. And you have done that. And so we ought to be, you and I personally ought to be in touch over the time ahead.
Yes.
And share with us, you've got an outreach. You got all these books. You're surrounded. You write a book like I used to write a letter home to my mother. You know, you write books on, and they're all interesting and worth reading and so forth. Are you getting into multimedia? Are you getting into a way of distributing some of this stuff by television and by Alta Media and the internet and so forth?
Oh, yes, absolutely, Harold.
And are you hip to how to make it work?
But Mike Adams, who's been ranked as number two most influential on the internet, actually was shocked when an early interview he'd done with me about my book on Sandy Hook, which was banned by Amazon, was taken down by YouTube. It was an interview he'd done with me in 2015.
Oh, wow.
Now listen, Harold.
Yeah.
He had the courage to interview me again.
Uh-huh.
I thought he probably wouldn't put it up. It took him 6 to 8 weeks, but when he did, he actually gave it the title he'd used to describe me at the end of the interview. He said, "Most dangerous mind in America interviewed on fake news and extreme censorship." Fake news and extreme censorship. We have to get restore the American values of freely exchanging our opinions. We can't believe to sort out the difference between the true and the false if we can't speculate, conjecture, guess about what's going on. That's a crucial stage.
You ought to try and do that a little bit, James Fetcher. You ought to try and think outside the box a little bit.
I love it.
My brother. We're going to be in touch with you, okay? And this is going to go. We're going to put this out on the internet. Do we have your approval to put this out on the internet?
100%, Harold.
110%, right. Ladies and gentlemen, your pleasure. James H. Fetcher, you can see it there. Distinguished McKnight. I grew up, my best friend was McKnight. He lived right next door to me when I was a lad. So thank you very much, James, for not only this program, but for such a very, very well-led life that continues to be, it must be very boring not to be interested in everything.
You're a wonderful man, Harold Channer. What you're doing here is very important, not only to the residents of New York, but to the citizens of the world.
Thank you. Well said, sir. Well, I like that. Can I quote that?
You may indeed.
You're right. No lawyers. No lawyers involved in the contracting. Okay?
You got it.
Okay. Be in touch, pal. Be in touch. Now get on to your program. You got an appointment with your...